Just update-wise, the only real issue we had coming out of the game last night was a concussion. Luke Gifford had a concussion kind of on that opening kickoff, so he'll be out a little bit. Other than that, injury-wise, we came out pretty clean. Nothing to note of any issue. Hopefully this week, I think, projecting to get kind of Quandre back in a normal rotation as we kind of ramped him into the training camp process. He should be back sort of at a full load. So that should be good to get him there. And then I think we should expect to get Jamal back this week, as well as probably Leroy Watson. That's tentative, but hopefully get him back this week as well by Wednesday or Thursday. So good week, exciting week coming up. Gonna get a little joint practice work and a chance to work against the Seahawks on Wednesday and Thursday. So that'll be great. But good to come out of the game pretty clean. And I feel the same way as I felt last night. I think there's a lot of really positive things from the game. And I think that there's plenty of things that we got to coach and get better at. So good start for us for sure. Plenty to clean up. So with that, I'll let you guys fire away.
You said that you were eager to see a lot of Jalen Harrell. He played with the ones, twos, and threes last night. What did you see from him on the film?
I saw plenty of positive. He was physical against the run. He set the edge. I thought his pass rush was solid. I think there's probably more there. I think a lot of the rookies in particular, myself included, there's some nerves in that first game, and there's some things that you don't end up cutting it all the way loose, and you're kind of feeling your way through it. I thought that was kind of common for all of those guys, really, all the rookies that were playing for the first time. So there was some initial nerves, and hopefully you see a good jump in that second game, and they play a little bit more they cut it loose a little bit more, and you see a better version of them. So, there's some ups and downs there. But I thought he put a good physical showing on in the run game, and I think the pass rush, I think we'd like to see more from that, the next time we get out there.
How did Andre's practice success translate into that setting?
It was good. I think there was same thing. I think he was nervous to start the game. He's kind of settled down a little bit as it went on. I mean, he was active. But just didn't see that, didn't make any splash plays or anything, but, kind of rotated him through. And I think it was good for him to feel, that everybody in the NFL is big and strong, and he's going to have to do a lot of things technically that need to get improved. And so that part was good for him. It was a good learning experience for him. But you still felt him. He still took up double teams. He still disrupted the line of scrimmage. He can hold the point of attack, and that was all good things to see. So positive first starts, plenty to clean up for him as well.
Trying to get the ball to Ridley and, dialing up plays for him. How do you go about balancing? Like, you want to do that, but you also want to not show so much in the preseason.
Yeah, we got some core basic things that, if you watch both sides of the ball, their offense and ours, there was a lot of similar concepts that they ran to. So there's plenty of things we have at our disposal that's common for the NFL that isn't giving anything away. Tried to get him on the fade ball. In the low red zone, we had an out route to him that the flat defender buzzed underneath, and it was a really nice play by Will to reset and throw the ball to the back as that coverage left the interior part of the field. So, and then he did a really nice job on that shallow cross. He sits down versus zone, and Will puts it right on the right shoulder. He turns with the ball, and then he does the rest of it with his ability, and which was good to see. So, glad he got a catch. Wanted to get him one or two in the game and get him out. Wanted to get one for Tyler. I didn't get the two calls I had for Tyler. I didn't get to based on the early part of the game. I wanted to get him a catch or two and didn't. But everybody else, I think, got at least a target or two just so we could get moving, get those guys back feeling football again.
How do you approach the week with Seattle? And does what you do during the week impact what you might do on Saturday as far as play time?
Yeah, it will. It will affect it. I mean, I'd like to get it's going to be too it's supposed to be hot. We're practicing a little bit later because of they're on West Coast time. So we're trying to accommodate the schedule. It's going to be hotter. It's going to be more physical because you're playing against somebody else. So I'm hoping for two great days of controlled physical work against them. And that will likely lead to some of the starters playing less in this game just because of the amount of work they're going to get in practice. So, I'll officially give you some more playtime information at the end of the week, but I think that, the starting point is going to be to play just probably a little bit less, if at all, depending on how the two practices go against Seattle. So just because it's going to be such a heavy load on those guys. And emphasis will be for the ones to get a lot more reps, and then the twos and threes will play a lot more in the game. So
you talk a lot about experience for these young guys, but for you calling plays yesterday with this new team, yeah. What did you think of that, and I guess how do you think you did?
I thought it went well. You know, I was, you know, always critical of the operation for the first time. I think there was plenty of things that, you know, communication-wise between me and our game management folks and special teams and some things that minor that are worth cleaning up, I think, on a communication perspective. Felt good calling plays. It's a lot of fun. Really enjoyed it. I thought I did a pretty good job of making sure we got the plays in on time. We didn't really have any, I think I had one or two kind of late on the play clock plays. I tried to avoid that as best I could. Let those quarterbacks play, not have to worry about the clock too much. I thought it was a good first outing. I mean, you know, everybody that's out there for the first time, Denard, me, Colt, I think we all had enough nerves too, just the first time doing it. So it was good to get one under our belt. I feel a lot better now than I did 24 hours ago.
We're calling plays. How does the personnel work? Let's use the running backs as an example. Mm-hmm. So is it Randy or Nick that's deciding if it's Tony or Tajay, or are they tagged to the play that you're calling? How's that
They work? Are tagged, especially in the preseason, you know, this early part, and we knew we were only going to get a handful of plays. So I was very intentional about tagging them on the plays I wanted to get them in on. So they rotated pretty cleanly. They knew what plays they were going to be in for in that first set of plays. So that was intentional. It'll be some version of that in the regular season as well. You're just making sure that we put them on the plays that they feel great about. I'm not going to say it's going to rotate every other play or anything like that. It kind of felt like that early on. But, we'll tag those guys on most plays when we want those guys in the game. And we'll be more intentional, too, about where we put the other receivers as well. You know, we're going to have 5 to 6 guys up on game day, and those guys all have roles. They'll have plenty of different places. We'll tag those guys, too. So that process is usually done during the course of the week, and on game day it's pretty well settled.
Sticking with the running backs, mm-hmm. How do you view Chestnut and Haskins right now? Were you mm-hmm. kind of using them the way you used Pollard and Spears?
Yeah, we're trying to get a good look. That's a position battle, you know, that third back role. And the special teams comes into that as well. I think Hassan played really, really well in special teams yesterday. I think Julius was solid. I thought Julius had a better day on the ground carrying the ball and in the passing game. But that's a job that's being competed for, you know. I think that they're both bigger backs. They're strong. They're physical. So that role is an important one. It's an important one for special teams, and I think that's a battle you're going to continue to see over the next, you know, 2.5-3 weeks.
A luxury, probably not.
Four would depend on the rest of the roster, but the third one for sure. Fourth would be, again, depending on what the rest of it would look like. But yeah, more luxury than not.
Having 5 to 6 receivers up. Do you see a path for Jaquan being a guy who can help at receiver, or is mm-hmm.
Okay. No, he's actually done a nice job. He's getting better technically, running routes, knowing how to use, you know, he's not a stature wise, not big. And so he's learning how to get in and out of cuts and learning how to use leverage. So that part's good. He's come a long way, I think, even since the OTAs for that role. But, you know, if he can return the ball consistently like he did last night, then that's going to provide him some opportunity as well. So happy with where he's at. I mean, he's got a ways to go still, too. I think a lot of them do. But it's been positive for him.
With a couple of the interior linebackers down for the count last night, what did you see from guys like Chance Campbell, Otis Reese, and James Williams that really stood out to you last night?
Yeah, excited about those guys. You know, I think it was a great outing for Chance. You saw his confidence kind of start to bloom, and that's a good thing. He played loose and fast and aggressive, all the things we want to see from those guys. Otis did as well. I mean, those guys both had a really nice game, I thought. And they're getting opportunities. And so when you get opportunities, you got to make the most of them. And I think to their credit, they have. And James, I think, I don't think James even knows how good he could be yet. He's still learning the position as a converted safety. But he's got some things that he flashes that are really impressive. And so that's a battle. There's some battles going on back in that back of the linebacker room, and they're taking advantage. All of them have taken advantage of increased opportunity because of the injuries that have occurred, and I'm really happy that they have.
A ton of rotation at the kick and punt return spots. It was mainly Jaquan or Kiaris that took those reps. I guess why that approach, and are you going to want to get a look at some of those other guys in the preseason games that are to come?
Yeah, that was intentional. I mean, we knew we wanted to get good long looks at both of those guys in both phases. And so just because you only get so many in a game, that we wanted to make sure that they got a good long run at the returner spots. And both of them popped a good return. I thought it was a pretty solid outing for both of them, but Yeah, there'll be some other times for guys to play. We just wanted those guys we didn't know don't know a lot about, and so we wanted to make sure that, they got plenty of opportunities for us to get a chance to evaluate them.
You saw the film of the offensive line. Was it technique-wise and cohesion-wise as good as what it appeared the result was last night?
Yeah, I thought it was a good outing from top to bottom. There was some good kind of all the way around, and there's plenty of things, you know, as you guys get to know my dad, it's never, ever good enough, but that's just the way it is, and they're going to keep getting coached. But I thought, you know, from an overall perspective, I thought they went out and showed well for themselves as a unit. You know, we opened up some holes in run game. We only gave up one sack, and that was a quarterback's sack. So, yeah, good start. I mean, there's not a lot of things that I would – there's a lot of detail that I could go into that would probably be a little bit boring, but for the most part, I would say that it was a positive first start with plenty of room to grow.
Anybody in the second group stand out or above anybody else, or and will those guys get more looks?
No, I think Brunskill's always going to be solid and steady. I thought Rupich actually showed well for himself as well. I think that was a good game for him. He was a positive performance. JD does some really nice things, and he's just got to keep coming. You know, the consistency is the biggest factor, and but good things in the game to see him go out and play that way. But you know, I think there's still plenty of room for those guys to grow all the way around. But I think, you know, Brunskill showed up, did a nice job, and Rupich was one that I think had a nice game as well. Go ahead.
Yeah, when I talked to Jaquan after the game yesterday, he was kind of so happy for Kiaris and what Kiaris had shown on kickoff. I'm curious, as a head coach, how you nurture a culture where guys celebrate their teammates making a play in camp when they're fighting for the same jobs and same opportunities to have themselves stick out.
Well, I think because you got the right makeup of people, you know, that's the first part. I mean, I think these guys genuinely do care about each other, and I think that as a head coach is the kind of culture you want, where they do root for each other's success. You know, they're, even though they are competing, they are genuinely happy for guys when they play well. And I think you saw one of the things I thought last night was really cool is I thought our sideline energy was outstanding, and I thought guys excited for their teammates making plays. And one of the things I mentioned before the game to our team was that, you know, we talk about, you guys have heard it before, but, you know, we talk about hunting together. And that was the first time we'd had a chance to do that, and as a team against somebody else. And I thought they did a great job of rooting and encouraging and picking up and being excited for all the things that went on in the game. And they're all competing for jobs, but just to see that type of camaraderie, that kind of connection amongst our team was really cool to see. And I think that when you have the right guys and they approach their job the right way, they can separate the competition from wanting to see other people do well. And I think that's a sign of a team that's got a pretty good connection and really is, you know, building each other up and building a positive place to come to work. So I think it's a positive sign for me as a head coach.
You guys have added, you know, the veteran safeties. What do you say to guys like Matthew Jackson, Elijah, you know, Mike Brown, Shai Carter, those guys? Like, what do you say to them, and how do you feel they've responded to that addition of guys at their same position?
It just ramps up the competition, and I think that anytime you bring in a veteran player or a player that's played significant snaps in the league, you know, it's a little sort of a shot across the bow to everybody else in the room, intentional or not, that everything's got to pick up because someone else has now entered the mix to try to take your job. And that's the reality of the NFL, and that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that, and I think they understand that the competition is a part of it, and you hope that raises the level of play for everybody and you get the best out of all those guys competing. And there's really not much you have to say. They all understand. They know how it all works, and, you know, that the competition is on, and there's expectations that the performance matches that stuff, and I think that you hope it brings the best out of guys.
Would it be difficult to keep a fifth or even sixth safety?
Six would be difficult. You know, fifth is, again, depending on the makeup all the way around. Those are your debates that you have is, you know, is it a fifth safety over a linebacker or over another DB, over a tight end? It's that all starts to become a holistic roster picture as opposed to just the position. So those are the debates that we'll have coming up here as we get closer. And again, a lot of that has to do with the special teams performance and where your four core guys are coming from. So yeah, six is probably not realistic, but there's certainly a conversation for five.
Is your expectation at this point that Jeff Harold and Legarius are going to keep sitting through the preseason?
That would be my expectation. Yeah, not to say that can't change, but that would be the expectation. I don't need to see a lot of Jeff and Harold. Those guys have kind of proven it, and Legarius won't play in the preseason. I don't foresee that being the case. And, you know, maybe we decide by the last week that Harold and Jeff go out for a couple of plays just to knock the pads around. But as of right now, I don't know that those guys will play.
For the tight ends last night, it seemed like it was pretty clearly defined who was playing that more Y type of role in the F role. If you were to only keep, say, three tight ends, is there maybe an opportunity for flexibility for one of those guys to play either the Y or the F? Oh, yeah. Or would that be more of a discussion to have four on the roster?
No, those are discussions that are kind of upcoming. And I think we got guys that are versatile enough to play in both spots. Again, it's always that fourth tight end is going to be a special teams role at the end of the day. Are they really contributing on special teams and really helping that as a four-phase starter? But I think we have – I was pleasantly surprised. I thought DMR did a really nice job in the game. I thought Thomas did some good things. I think that room has really come along. I think they've really grown. And even Steven did a nice job in the game as well. Just hadn't seen him play much live action, and he even did some good things. So they're all competing. They're doing a really good job. We got versatile guys that can play Y and F for us. And again, it's just going to be a matter of, you know, what does the fourth tight end do in the third phase of the game?
You threw to Odukoya right after the penalty. Is that a coincidence or a reassurance?
There's a little bit of both. I mean, it's some coincidence, and I knew he was in there, but it's also I don't like guys to have to worry about penalties and think too much about it. And it was a silly one. You're talking about the one where he lined up offsides. I mean, he just. Little awareness, you know where the line of scrimmage is, and I think he bounced back just fine. And sometimes I do that is intentional when you're trying to get a guy back and not have to think about a mistake, and you just try to get him going again. So he did a nice job. He was warned previously on a shift that he was too tight, and in that one he was kind of egregiously across the line of scrimmage. So that wasn't great.
Are there any things that you'll do in these joint practices with the Seahawks upcoming that will kind of enhance things maybe that you wouldn't do going just your offense versus your defense?
The 2 minute stuff is good to get against another defense, another team. It's kind of hard to simulate in a practice for us. You know, it's just because it's a competitive situation, and you try to stay out of some of that stuff, but I think it'll be good. That's a good thing to get against them. Other than that, it'll be pretty standard operation for us. There's not going to be a whole lot that you're going to do against them that you haven't seen us do thus far. So, but just going to be against another uniform, which is good.
On a couple of fourth down plays, sure. Is that a preseason take a chances kind of thing, or is that a sign of things to come?
It's both. You know, I think we're going to maintain our aggressiveness when our analytics would tell us that it's the right time to go. The one in the low red zone was sort of a dealer's choice ultimately. Can choose to go for that, or you can take the points. Probably in real life, you know, you probably take the points there after 17 plays. But in the preseason, I was just trying to see if we could punch a yard and try to go up 21-7, which would have been good. And then the flip side of it is you pin the offense back down there. And we had them on third and long and a chance to flip the field and get the ball right back with a good field position. So that's all. Those are conversations we had during the game. And again, whether I do that, depending on who we're playing in the regular season, we'll see. The one at the end of the game was a very clear go for it. But from our book on, you know, where we were at, where the field goal was at, and chance to ice the game. So that one would probably be one that in a normal flow of a game I would still consider going for, given the score and where we were at in the field. So we'll be aggressive on fourth down as long as it's, you know, within the parameters of how we got the game set up. And it varies game to game. Depends on who you play. Depends on the short yardage defense. Depends on the third down defense. All those things factor in. But I would anticipate some at least being along the lines of correct in our thinking on fourth down. We won't be afraid to go for it.
On the operational mechanics of the tagging we were talking about.
Yeah.
you're calling the play to Will.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody else on the staff is hearing play call.
Yep.
They're repeating it to their position group.
Yes.
And so the running back's taking it from Randy.
Yep.
Say, and he's getting it from
there. Yeah. And so a lot of times what I'll do is it'll be on the call sheet. Their names will be, you know, kind of tagged on those things. And usually I'll do my best to give them a heads up. You know, after I've called that first play, I say, hey, if we're first second down here, I'm going right to this one. So they kind of have a preview. And so I'm always trying to think ahead as well. But generally speaking, I try to give them a heads up. Occasionally, every now and again, I might call a play and I'll just tell Randy, hey, hey, give me Tony on this one, or give me Tajay on this one, or I'll tell Tyke, hey, I need Traylon on this one, I need Nick Westbrook. They'll know kind of in the moment. And they're always paying attention for that stuff.
Were you able to follow what was happening on defense?
Yeah.
Or were you with the offense? Just kind of how'd you handle that on the sideline?
It was good. I'd flip. I trust those guys offensively to handle all the adjustments we need to make. And I would be over there a little bit, and then I'd always flip over to defense, and I just listen to their communication during the game. And again, I trust those guys too, and so I just was listening and observing and seeing how their communication went for their first time. So yeah, I was pretty easy flipping back and forth from offense to defense and paying attention to them during the, you know, downtime between offensive series. And I would flip back at some point if I needed to catch up and make any corrections or make any notes on my call sheet. So that part was pretty seamless. And I thought the special teams, you know, Colt and I had probably one or two things that we got to clean up on our communication on that third phase, which was that part's new for me. So it was good to make a few mistakes now, and doesn't matter too much.
When you were in Cincy, were you a sideline offensive coordinator upstairs? And what is the benefit of having Nick upstairs kind of while you're downfield level?
Yeah, it's a huge benefit. You know, you see the game so much different upstairs. It's, you know, much 30,000 foot view, if you will. And it's really helpful for those that information coming down from upstairs. They see, you can see more. I have a better feel on the field for kind of how, you know, body language and rotations, those things that I saw pretty well during the game. But just having another set of eyes upstairs that can help recommend plays and give me some more information on what's happening is super helpful, which is the role that I played in Cincinnati for all those years.
Chestnut thing you were talking about, how much is that kind of a typical 53 decision you're deciding? But if they are, as you said,
yeah,
like one's a better running back, one's a better special teamer, and you're deciding what's more important?
Yeah, every year. I mean, that's a very traditional standard, you know, roster decision every year. Running, it's third running back, it's your fourth tight end, it's your fourth or fifth safety. Those are all, I would say, almost every year you're having a conversation in one of those spots about that exact thing. So not new in any way. Pretty standard operating procedure.
Play last night, but you were talking about Nick being upstairs and all. When it comes to replay, is it a group effort to decide when to challenge, or is there somebody that takes the lead on telling you challenge that or don't challenge
that? That's a good question. Yeah. So the way we're set up on game day is Rob Reederer is our kind of game management. He's the one that I hear most of the game. He does all the 2-minute stuff, the game, the clock management, the field positioning stuff, timeouts, when to take them. He's sort of the one that I hear all the time, and he's like the rules expert on top of it. So he's the one that if a penalty comes up or we have a replay, he knows exactly what the ruling should and could be, and he communicates that to me. Now, we didn't have any last night. I wish we did. I would have liked to have had a shot or two of one of those potential reviews, but he's the one that watches it. He'll be the one that makes the final decision because he's got such intimate knowledge of the rule book and how they're going to rule those things, and so he's the one that does it. And then we have Scott Cohen as well, who's helps in along that process, and him and Rob on game day are sort of working tandem together with the management part of the game. And that's everything from, again, timeouts, clock management, replay, any situational calls that I need to be kind of aware of. They sort of help. They're sort of always monitoring that part of the game while I'm doing the offense and defense and special teams. So those guys have been fantastic, super, super smart. Lucky we have them, and I've been pleased with where we've gone from there. We also have a Saturday morning meeting with the coordinators where we go watch a bunch of situations from around the league and debrief any situations that have come up for us. And I thought Rob did a really nice job with that this week leading up the first time we sort of did it together as a group. Was really, really well done. So excited about those guys. I think those guys are both an asset, both Rob and Scott, for us in the management portion. So helps me a ton.
Do you have any upstairs, downstairs decisions? Are you set on who's where on your staff?
I would say 99% set. I mean, there, you know, maybe something that comes up, but I would say for the most part, we're pretty much set.
Okay.